1st, 1950. What happened May 5th? Anybody know? 1950, May 5th, what happened in the United States? The Korean War broke out.
Got it.
Right? Oh boy, I got phone calls, I got letters. Hey, Sergeant, come on in, you're now a captain. You're now a major. I said, no, I'm a civilian. He said, no, no, you come in, you give me. I said, no, I'm a civilian. You know, civilian, you know, none of this crap, none of this stuff. I'm a civilian. He said, come on in, we'll make you a captain, we'll make you. I said, no. Those are days are over, that's finished, that's finished. And let me just say something to you. I think, yeah, they called me Lucky Saul, and I was lucky all through that period. I got hit twice, but that wasn't so bad. But when I came home, that was the best thing. The lady I met and married was the most gorgeous, 6 feet tall, a concert pianist. She was absolutely gorgeous. And she would take me in her arms at night and say, honey, it's over. It's over. And I'd be screaming and hollering. And she said, it's over. It's all over. And this went on week after week after month after month until finally it got to a point where I could go to sleep and not wake up for a whole night. Sleep all through the night. She was my therapist and everything else. Now, so I got lucky again, lucky son. And we were married for 60 years. I lost her 10 years ago. But she gave me 3 fabulous sons. So I'm doing this because one of the sons' daughter, my granddaughter, my youngest granddaughter, said to me about 25, 30 years ago, Poppy, come on out and talk to my school in Minneapolis. She says, we have a gypsy man here. I said, gypsy man? Yeah, he's a gypsy man. He said he was incarcerated at Buchenwald. And I told him that you're one of the liberators. I went out there and I listened to him speak to the school. And after, he said, now I want to introduce you to Saul Goldstein, who liberated me. I said, what? So I got him to start speaking. And she said, when you go back to Baltimore, you have to tell this story. So I came back to Baltimore and I told the Baltimore Jewish Council, I was president of them. We started a forum, a group. We got survivors, people who had actually been in these camps, looking like the people I described who survived, who were willing to go out and talk about it. And we've been doing that now for years. Spielberg has done a lot of videos of us and everything. But the main thing is that we're able to convey to you a story that when we're gone, you'll only read in books, you'll see pictures, maybe TVs and so forth. But today, you're looking at somebody who was there, who was part of it. I thank you for inviting me, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. Thank you very much.
No one has any questions? Okay, let me put it out there first. I'll write the pass, or I'll sign the pass for you to your next class.
This young lady had her own.
What was it like coping with everything that you like went through after you got out?
What was it like coping with everything when I came out?
Like, what was it like going through, like, the process of, like, getting out?
There were a couple. What was it like coping with life when I came out of service? Well, the first thing was not to jump in people's face and not to be ready to fight, drop a pin. And not having somebody say, because when I was there, I didn't tell you, I took an oath, I swore that if you was in trouble and I could help, I'd be there. If anybody needed my help, and they weren't as big and ugly as me, I would be there to help. So after the war was over, I went to Israel, and I was with the Israeli army, and all the way to Lebanon. And I left and came back because I didn't want to give up my American citizenship. I spent 6 weeks in Ethiopia, the Simeon Mountains, bringing out black Jews called the Falasha from there into Israel. I spent 35 years in and out of the Soviet Union. Spent 2 nights in one of their jails, getting Jews out of the Soviet Union they wouldn't let out. I was one of the 3 people to form a group in Baltimore called the Blues, the black Jewish form of Baltimore. They wouldn't let me go down to Tennessee or to North Carolina and so forth because they said, you got to be able to have somebody kick you in the scrotum and so forth and hit you in the head and everything and call you the ass and everything else and not fight back. I said, no, not me. You can't go. went over park. I said, okay, I'm going there. We're going to picket that place and everything. No, you can't, because they're going to jump on you and you're going to fight back. You can't fight back. I said, it's not my nature. Well, you can't fight back. So I've spent my whole life doing this. And I feel good about it, because I see people today and they say, hey, Sal, how are you? Hey, Lucky, how are you? And people that I worked with over the years are in Baltimore and other places. And so I've kept my promise. That's why. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
Excuse me. Do you still live in Baltimore?
Speak up.
Do you still live in Baltimore?
Do I still live in Baltimore? Yes. Yeah, yeah. This is my home. This is my Raven Man or one. Yes.
When I talk to the medals, you said you threw them away. And you said you were not going going to wait one more day. What happened to the medals? Did you get them back again, or did you stay on the floor?
The medals. What happened with the medals?
The medals? Oh, I'll tell you what happened with the medals. You see, I'm wearing the Purple Heart, and I'm wearing a combat badge. This combat badge is given only to people who are in combat, and there are two stars on it, which designate three battles I was in: Normandy, Battle of Bulge, and Germany. And the reason is that my youngest grandson is a captain in the United States Air Force. He was a fighter pilot, now he flies a big C-70. And he is a real nut about history and everything. He said, Pop, what would you do? And so he checked and got my history and everything, and he ordered all the medals that I had issued to me, and he made them into miniature medals for me. And I've only, and then last year, the French government, I was invited to the French embassy, and they presented me with what is called the Chevalier de Légion d'Honneur, the highest award the French government gives, like our Legion of Honor, for whatever I did in France. And so I have those little ones now. And I'm aware of them. I sometimes wear this when I come to speak or something like that. But otherwise, it's wonderful. It's fine. My grandson thinks I'm crazy. You earn them, wear them. I've had too many buddies who wonder if they're, And I have never been back to Normandy. All these years, I've been to France a dozen times. My wife should say, let's go to Normandy. I've never been back there. Because of too many memories, too many friends, and we're still there. Yes,
sir. He said you were never able to graduate.
Oh, yeah. I didn't graduate in the city, but what happened is that I have a school, favorite school, and it's John Carroll Senior High out there.
Okay.
It's a fabulous Catholic school. They gave me an honorary degree. I got a GPA from the city, but they gave me an honorary graduation. That's right. I did graduate from John Carroll. We couldn't go to college. My mom wanted me to go to college when I came back and everything, but the idea of sitting in a classroom with people, even though they're my age, is so hadn't been no more, whatever it was, or even veterans, I just couldn't handle it. I couldn't handle it. So what did I do? I saved up some money, and I knew two things. I knew how to fight. I knew how to drink. So I bought a bar. And I had one of the largest bars in Baltimore, Fulton Avenue, Baker Street. And I ran it like General Motors. It was 16 barmaids and so on. And I did it 13 years. Now, suddenly one morning, having breakfast, I'm 35 years old, got and said to my wife, I had three sons, I said, this isn't for me. This isn't what I'm going to do. I don't want to do this. So I called my partner. I said, you buy me out, I'll buy you, and I'm finished. And then I walked away from it. And went to the insurance business. Somebody convinced me to go to the insurance business. So for 47 years, I was in the insurance business. Made $1 million round table almost every year, and was able to travel and do all the things I've told you about, because the only boss I had was right here, time. And here I am, doing the thing I like most, and that is talking to young people. Anybody else got a question? Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What would you have done if you didn't go to war?
What would you have done if you didn't go to war? What would you have done if you didn't go to war?
What would I have done if I didn't go to war? I don't know what I would have done. I was always physical, so after the war, when I came home, I was a horseman. I had Tennessee walking horses. I showed them in competition. I showed them four or five states. You know, you're familiar with the Tennessee walkers. The gated horse, the front was go like this. Anyway, I did this for a number of years. I took a bad fall about 6 years ago. My son said no more, so I sold my horses. And I was a runner. I ran three or four marathons. I used to run every day, 5, 6, 8 miles every day. I was just very active. I couldn't sit still. I just had to be go. And now, my three sons, my youngest son down in Dallas, Texas, he runs 5, 6 miles a day. I'm so happy. The other two, the older one rides a bike occasionally. The middle one talks about it, but anyway. But they're all great. Great kids, great grandkids. I have 5 grandchildren, 10 great-grandchildren. And hopefully more to come. What else? Yes, sir.
Hey, so you said that you started something with the like black Jewish thing called like the blues.
Yeah. Never heard of it? Yeah. The black Jewish forum called blues, BL-EWS. Black Jewish Forum, we formed it way back in the 60s. And for example, we used to protest the apartheid in South Africa. We picketed the courthouse down in Charlotte, Lumber Street. They had arrested all of us because we wouldn't get out of the courthouse. But protesting apartheid in South Africa. We had meetings at Coppin, and 2 years it would be a Jewish president. Next 2 years would be an African-American person who's president. And we did, we were all kind of, even today, it's even I've been away, so it still works because under Congressman, what's his name?
Roger
Cummins, we formed a group, and every year they send, I think, 25 children for a week in Israel and a week in Zanzibar, Africa. To come and join us out. And it's a fabulous program to just show the unity between. But I'm gonna tell you all something. Those weeks I spent in Ethiopia with the most gorgeous, beautiful people you have ever seen. These people will be gorgeous. If you want to see, if any of you don't know an Ethiopian person, you'll know what I'm talking about. And these people endured such terrible, terrible, terrible things. The government there, a guy named Mengistu, who was a guy who ousted the king, he would close all the markets during the week and open one Saturday and Sunday because he knew that these people would not shop on the Sabbath because they were observing. He would take pigs and drag them through their village, which was an obscenity, a terrible, terrible thing. Now, when we would go into a village, let's say there's 125 people, we couldn't take 10, 15 people. We had to take the whole village, all 150. Because if you left any behind, the militia would come in and kill them. So we would take them and we would walk across the Simien Mountains at night into the Sudan. And in the Sudan, there was an old army air base from World War II. And there was a guy in Belgium that had freight planes who would fly them into the Sudan. We'd put these people in their half naked rags. And we would fly them. We couldn't fly them into Israel. We'd fly them to Greece. We'd fly them to London. We'd fly them to Paris. We'd fly them to Brussels. And from there to Israel. Because the deal with the Sudanese, which was a Muslim country, was not to fly them direct to Israel. So it was just a fabulous thing. If you saw these people, I'll give you an illustration. There was one young lady who was so gorgeous. She was so beautiful. And we said, okay, we'll take it. She said, I'm not going. I said, what do you mean I'm going? And now this is through an interpreter, by the way, because I didn't speak Amharic and she didn't speak English. She said, my husband is in the army and he's fighting in Eritrea. And I said, but you gotta go, we can't leave you, they'll kill you. I'm not going. Well, the bottom line is we took him, left her, and about 2 years later, 2 years, 3 years later, I was in Israel. And my wife and I said to my wife, I'm going to I'm going downstairs and get a copy of the newspaper and while you're getting dressed. So I went down and walked over to the counter and I looked at this woman and I said, Bokatov, which in Hebrew is good morning. And she says, Bokatov, and she looks at me and says, Shlomo! In Hebrew, my name is Shlomo. And I looked at her and I said, Sarita! And I jumped across the counter and grabbed it. It's her. It's gorgeous, gorgeous. And she got out a year later and she's working here in the front desk of this hotel in Tel Aviv. And she's speaking beautiful English and Hebrew, and she's got two children. And so I thought, that's all worth it. It's all worth it. Everything's worth it. You see that? Everything I did to work. Yes? I thank you so much for inviting me, and goodbye.